Hello. Last year I made a video where I compared the transmission quality of various antenna types and NRF24L01 module types to see how far they could go before they just got useless, basically. And to do that, I counted the number of packets per second that were being received and compared that with the number of packets that were being received at point blank range right next to the transmitter. So I used the packets per second at the point blank range is like 100% RSSI kind of a measurement. And at the time, I lived in Tokyo, which was a little bit unfortunate for this kind of thing because it meant that it was very, very difficult to get a long distance in with a clear line of sight. And there was also a fair bit of other radio noise around the area. So the way I did it was by putting a receiver onto the top of my bicycle helmet, or ski helmet actually, this one. And I just rode around, and the packets were being counted by an Android app that I had wrote. So I'll put a link to this video in the description if you want to go and watch all about that. But now that I'm here in New Zealand and I have a lot more space to do this kind of thing, and I have a quadcopter that can reliably fly almost 2.5 kilometers away and back again without crashing almost all the time, I thought, instead of doing it the primitive way where I use my legs to pedal and stuff, when I have a flying robot that can do it for me, why don't I just use that? So that's what I've been doing for the last few days, or over the last few days. So the way I've got it set up is everything has to be a little bit more compact. So my idea to do this was to use the EEPROM and save, I'll show you the source code in a minute, but save the data on the EEPROM basically, so it'll be very, very limited. But just to look at the hardware setup, we have a Arduino Pro Mini on here, and this has a LED just to give us some feedback about what's happening. Don't underestimate the value of having some feedback like this. I've decided to put something like this on. Anytime I get a little bit stumped as to what's going on, I'm going to put this on, and boy, it saves you a lot of time. So this is connected to, obviously, over here we have a NRF24L01 radio module, and this is one of the ones that IC Station sells. Oh, it has a black spot on it because this is one of the ones that I thought I'd ruined it by connecting. Powering it with no antenna on, but I guess it's okay because it's been working fine. Maybe I could take the black spot off. And the antenna is just a normal rubber ducky dipole one like that. And that's just using the normal RF24 library that I've always been using. And then on the hardware UART, we have coming over here a GPS module. So the quadcopter has its own GPS there, but just to make this little system completely separate to that, I'm using GPS here. So for the first few tests that I did, I used, as I said, the EEPROM, and I stored all the data in here, and that gave me some problems. So what I have stuck on this side is, you can see a bunch more connections on the left-hand side there. Those connections are going to this level shifter, which go through to the front. And on the front of the quad, we have an SD card reader, writer. So as you can imagine, that lets me store a lot more data in a lot more sophisticated way as well. So that's what I've ended up doing for the latter part of the test, and it's much, much better. The level shifter, by the way, I'm not totally sure that this was necessary. I was having some problems that turned out to be probably an issue with the source code, but I left the level shifter in there anyway because it was working, so I just left it there. It doesn't add too much more weight, and if it's working, just leave it alone, I guess. All right, this is the first sketch that I was using, and I've called this one GPS NRF EEPROM packet counter. So I'll just briefly look at some of this. The settings for the GPS are given here. Initially, I was using Software Serial for the GPS, and I found that the 10 hertz and the 5 hertz just really kill the whole thing, really. You can't handle that much data coming in on the Software Serial. So I changed it to 1 hertz, and I left it there because even though after switching to hardware UART, the 10 hertz and 5 hertz rates probably would not have been an issue. Again, if it's working, leave it alone. And in this case, 1 hertz is not such a bad rate because the it doesn't really matter. We don't need to update every 10 times a second for this kind of thing. There is a function here for calculating the distance between two geolocs, and geoloc is just a structure here. Somewhere here. It's just a float that has a latin along. So we have GPS code. This is the same code that I have in some of my other videos to figure out what the GPS is telling us about the location of where we are. The receiving function for the radio, all this does is count how many packets we've got. So it just increments a packet counter and that's it. It doesn't actually do anything with the data. This is the function to turn the LED off and on. So in the setup function, we just set up the radio and tell the GPS what kind of settings we want it to use. And then we do that, which is going to turn the LED on because we start with it off. And then in the main loop, we have two main sections. We've got this and then we've got that. So the first section decides if we have any valid GPS data available at the moment. So if process GPS returns true, that means we have just finished successfully passing a GPS message from the GPS. And fix type 3 means it's a proper 3D fix. So then we divide the latin along by 10 million to put it into one of those geolock structures. And then we have another check here. So when it first starts up, it's going to take 15 samples to determine what is the home location, the starting point. So this, I think I set this to 15. And then we just increment the counter there. And in here, we're just taking a sort of a running average of the first 15 points that we get from the GPS to use as our starting point. So after the first 15 iterations, we don't come in here anymore. And then receive data just checks the radio to see if there's any data coming in. And then this one here is kind of the opposite of this if statement here. So if we have finished the first 15 samples, then we're going to do this. And this is saying that if 1 second has passed, we're going to store a record. Then we're going to set packets to zero to start counting for the next record. And quite importantly, we're also going to say that the last record time is starting from now. So that just means that we don't actually count the time that it takes to store the record as part of the packets per second timing, which is quite important. And I actually screwed that up on my other video that I made last year, as we'll see shortly. So store record in this version is going to use the EEPROM. So this is the store record function here. And we look at, we look at the distance between what we decided was our home location and our current location. And we divide that by 10 because we need to fit it into the EEPROM in an efficient manner. And in my case, I'm going to be going up to 2300 meters away. If I divide that by 10, it'll be a value up to 230. And then I'm going to index my EEPROM data so that the even numbered bytes are going to be the distance, and then the odd numbers bytes are going to be the number of packets that I saw at that distance. So it's a bit boring to explain all of this here, but each time it comes through here, it's going to actually read what was in the EEPROM at those two bytes, and then it's going to do this calculation here, which gives a new value for this distance, and then writes it back to the EEPROM. So that's why we need to keep in the EEPROM, we need to keep track of how many samples we got at that distance and what the packets per second was at the distance as well. The reason we need to store how many samples we kept is so that we can do the averaging properly here. And this, as we'll see later, there's a bit of a problem here, and I'm not really sure what it is, but it all went away when I started using the SD card to store the data. I'll just play a little clip here from the first day when I started to set this up. All right, I'm just getting set up to do a trip here. It's sun has just gone down, so it's probably not the best time to be doing this, but I spent most of the day yesterday getting it set up, so I want to try it. So this is just my transmitter thing, and it's going to go on that fence post there. So let's do that. Turn it on. Not very flat, is it? Oh, now it is. Alright, so that's the transmitter. Should be transmitting. See if we can angle it up a little bit like that. Might be better. That'll do. Okay. Now over here, we have our Arduino Pro Mini on here. NRF is there. Power is not connected yet because I didn't want to waste too many of the samples while it was just sitting here warming up the GPS and stuff. GPS is there. Now what we want to do is put it over here, and this is going to be the base position. It is about 10 meters away from there, so all of these numbers are going to be 10 meters off or so. And then I'm going to plug this in, power it up. That means it's powered up. Now it's probably going to take about 15 seconds or so for the GPS to start giving it some coordinates. When we see that flashing, now it's recording samples. So we just want to get started at this point instead of screwing around too much longer. So let's do it. And this is the data that I got that day. At the bottom of the spreadsheet here, you can see the sheet names are dipole 2.3, dipole 1.3. So 2.3 is where I go all the way out to the water tank at the top of the hill. So that's 2.3 kilometers. And then dipole 1.3 is where I just went out to about halfway. And as you can see, at the home point, we're getting around 250 packets per second. And it doesn't change a whole lot until we get to about a kilometer. And then it drops off quite steeply. And the almost the same thing is true for the second trip, where we only went halfway. The only difference between these two trips is the speed that the quad was traveling at. So in this first one, you can see, so the distance here is in 10 meter increments, of course, because that's the way we index things in the EEPROM. And you can see that we're getting sort of 2, 3, 3, 3, 2, occasionally 4 samples per 10 meter slot. And this is, we can't tell if this was on the way out or on the way back, because it's just going to read the value at that distance as it passes by it and put in a new average. So that's why we just have one line on the graph. Well, we have two lines, but the one at the bottom is just the number of samples that was taken at that distance. So I guess this means this little bump up in the samples here, I think that would be, yeah, that would be where the quad sort of slowed down a little bit to, it almost kind of stops at the waypoint. So I had a waypoint that was about there. That's what that bump was. And this would be the waypoint on the way out. There's a little bump in the samples there. Now this, at first I thought this data looked kind of okay. But you can see that there's a funny situation going on here. We have sort of mostly about 250, and then we have some quite distinct measurements here that are around about 100, and they're all very, very closely around 100 or so there. And in this one, it's even more distinct that there's something strange going on, or even more obvious. And there's quite a bunch of them here that are at this level here. And this turned out to be, I think it's a problem with the code that we just looked at before, with the way I'm doing this averaging. So I think it's something in this line. Could perhaps be the fact that we are using some floating point values here and we're assigning it to a byte, so maybe the compiler's doing some preemptive rounding or something, is it? I don't know. But in the next sheet, we'll see even more obviously why that is a problem. But at this point, I was thinking that my calculations were still okay. So then the next day I went out to try a different antenna.
Okay, so today we are going to try something that I think may be a little bit more persuasive of the 2.4 gigahertz magical waves, and that is to replace this wimpy little half dipole or whatever these are with this big ass whopper Yagi, 14 parasitic elements on the front of that, and that's going to plug right onto my NRF module there. Better, yes, it does. And that feels pretty good. And this is kind of nice because I can point this exactly at the water tank right at the top. It's like perfectly aligned with it. So turn this on. It is on.
So let's have a look at how that big ass antenna worked out. Are you ready? Are you ready to be blown away by these numbers? Oh, you think I'm being sarcastic, don't you? Actually, no. It was very, very good. So we started off at 250 at the home point, roughly. And as it goes out to 2.3 kilometers, it barely changes. So we're still getting 240-ish packets per second at 2.3 kilometers away. And now it's even more obvious that there's something wrong with this data collection. So we can clearly see a line here that's going down here. I can't really see what the problem is with my calculations and storage, but it's some kind of integer calculation that's going wrong with the rounding, I think. And then this one is, what is this here? I think I just sent it straight back out because if I do it quickly, I can do two trips with one battery. So I just turned it around and did it again, I think. So this is basically the same kind of thing, but less distance. Okie dokie. So to get rid of this problem with the measurements being really wacky like that, I thought, screw it, I'll just change it completely and use an SD card to store the data. And that way I'll be able to store every single sample point and I'll be able to see which samples were going out and which samples were on the way back. So let's have a quick look at the source code for that. This one is going to be called GPS NRF SD packet counter, and the only thing that's different is the store. There's a little bit different in the setup function, but most of the difference is in the store record function. It's much simpler. So we just write almost as if we're writing to the serial port. We just do print and then print the distance and then the packets, and that's it. And then very important, we need to flush the file so that information actually gets stored on the disk before going any further. The other way you can make sure it's stored on the disk is to close the file, but then you have to open it again to write it next time, and that tends to be kind of slow. So what I wanted to do was open the file just once in the setup function, which is there, and then leave it open and then use flush to make sure that the data got written to the disk. So here's the SD stuff there. This was, of course, had to be added. And what I wanted to do was every time I reset the Arduino, I wanted it to start a new file to record the data. So that's what this is doing here. We're just looping up to a rather large number and checking if a file called data0text exists. And if it exists, then we keep going and we check if data1text exists and data2. And so, and sooner or later we'll find get to a point where the file name that we're checking does not exist. So we just break out of that loop and then open that file. So that means that all of the data will be nicely collated into separate files when we press reset. Very nice. So I think I have a little bit of video that I took after I tried this.
Well, we're on to the third day of testing now. I took this off overnight because, as you can see, we tend to get pretty heavy fogs here, and there's a lot of moisture in the air, and I didn't want it to be all wet. And when I came back the next day, look at the water on the grass there. It's midday, by the way. So I've been waiting for this fog to clear. I think it should clear soon, but there's no wind, which is kind of nice, but I guess that no wind makes the fog stay, I suppose. One problem is that I don't know where to point this exactly now, probably about there somewhere, but I'm gonna have to wait till the fog clears to do that. And I guess it doesn't really make any difference as far as flying is concerned, because once the quad gets a few hundred meters away, you can't see it anyway. But the problem is that it's about a 14, maybe 15 minutes or so flight, and over that time you tend to get quite a bit of condensation built up on everything. So yeah, it's not a matter of not being able to see that stops me from flying, it's just that it's going to get all wet when it comes back. And since I can't see where this is going to go, we're just going to have to wait a little bit, but shouldn't be too long. Well, that worked out okay. Weather is looking a little bit doubtful maybe, but I just wanted to show you one of the really neat points about using the SD card for storage instead of the EEPROM. It's going a bit slow, isn't it? Come on. So we can land that there, and we can turn that off. Quickly change our antenna. So this battery I've found, once I took the gimbal off my quad and made it much lighter, this 5200 milliamp hour 3S was able to get once out to the 2.3K mark at the top of the hill, which it just did. And then, if the speed is set to 7.5 meters per second, which is fairly fast, I can send it straight back out to about 1600 meters and do another run straight away. And because I have my SD card all set up to start another file, all I need to do here is reset the Arduino. That seemed rather quick, didn't it? Did that work? Hold on. I'm gonna reset you. That's better. So we should see a solid light for about 15 seconds or so. Yeah, but this was much easier than before, because before I would have to unplug it or power down the quad, take this whole thing inside, connect the FTDI adapter up to here, and download the EEPROM data, and then clear it, and then make sure the sketch was uploaded again. No, yeah, it was a nuisance, let's say. But now we can just send it straight back out. Oh shit. Let's be quick. And the other nice thing is that because I didn't reset the flight controller, I don't have to upload the mission again, because it's already in there, which is nice because I connected up my Bluetooth adapter the wrong way around for the voltage and busted it, so now I'm stuck with using a physical cable to connect. Anyway, what do we got here?
Now, unfortunately, the first time I tried this, I had the SD card and the NRF module both using the hardware SPI bus. And you're supposed to be able to do that. And I was using a different slave select pin for each of them, of course. And here's the results. And I've set this chart out a little bit differently. In the bottom, I have the distance. So this is starting at the home position. And then around about in the middle of the graph here, 2271, that's about the 2.3 kilometer mark. And then this is coming back. So it's a little bit different to the other one, because now we can see going out and coming back as well, and we can differentiate them. But the interesting thing to note is that the number of packets per second is basically irrelevant to anything except for time passing. And I did the same thing, and I sent the quad immediately back out again to about 1600 meters. And this was the result of that one. So about 8, 10, 12 packets or something like that. And all it is, if you look at this, at the end of this run, we had about 8 to 10 packets per second there. And then when we just continued with the same number of packets per second. So it turns out the SPI bus, it was working for the SD card writer, but basically the NRF module wasn't doing anything useful at all. So there was some kind of conflict between them that meant that the NRF module would report some data being received to the tune of about 80 packets per second at the beginning. And then over time, it just gradually deteriorated. So I would imagine that if we were actually trying to look at the data that was being received here, it would just be garbage. So that's why I decided to use the software SPI bus. Oh, here's another run like that. That's right. To confirm that this was the problem, notice that the distance here is just 1, 0, 1. So what I did for this test was I just set the quad still for about 5 minutes or whatever this is, with the radio transmitter off. So no packets, it should have just been zero all the way across. But instead we got the same silly nonsense with starting off at about 60, 70, whatever, and then just dwindling away. So anyway, to fix that, I just used a software SPI for this SD card reader instead. All right, so finally we get to the real results that I wanted to look at the beginning of this whole thing, which is this one. Ooh, that's nice, isn't it? So once again, I've changed the layout a little bit for this graph. You can see that there's four columns now. I just cut the data in the columns when I noticed that the numbers for the distance were descending now. So this is starting from the 2.3 kilometer mark and returning. And that just lets us put a different color line on the graph and label them so we can see which direction was which. And there is, what are we, outward is that way. So we can see that when we're coming back, we get slightly higher packet per second values. I guess maybe that's just to do with the way the quad is leaning forwards a little bit more than it's leaning towards us, towards the transmitter rather than away from it. You'll also notice now that the packets per second is 500 versus the 250 or so that we were getting at the beginning. And that is basically because I fixed my silly error. What I had done previously was I might just show this. What I did previously was wrong now equals, and then I did that, and then I did that. So it might look like I've just replaced some values there, but the important thing to note is that this store record takes some time, and the time that it takes here, if we use milliseconds before we do all this and we store it in a value, and then we waste some time doing something else, and then after that we say that time is actually still now, that's incorrect, because that will be counting the packets per second timing. It will be counting this as part of the time that it took to receive those packets, which is dumb. And that's actually what I was doing last year in my tests when I did this in Tokyo. So it's not a huge deal that I did that, because it still lets us evaluate how far the quality of the link can go. It's just that we're not getting the actual numbers of packets per second. So the correct value is around about 500 packets per second. And the size of the packets are 6 bytes, I think it was. Oh, float. Oh, sorry, no. Long, so that's 4, 4, 4. So it's 12 bytes per packet, yeah. So that's, what is that? So it's 500 bytes, 500 packets times 12 bytes times 8 bits per packet. So it's 48 kilobits per second. Yeah, that's reasonable, isn't it? Oops. And we're using the 250 kilobits per second speed there. So we're not getting anywhere near 250 kilobits per second, but it's still a pretty decent rate, I think. So it's about 50 kilobits per second in actual practice. Anyway, so the point of this test, I guess, was to compare the big Yagi antenna with the dipole. So I sent the quad out again. Once again, I think I just showed in the video clip just before, I switched the antenna over to the dipole and sent it back out immediately again. Unfortunately, I almost crashed in this one, and you can see right at this point the packets per second drops to zero. This is because the altitude of the quadcopter also dropped to approximately zero at that point. I think it may have actually touched the ground. I'm having a bit of an issue that every now and then it will just completely drop all the satellites. And it seems to be after turning around 180 degrees and returning back. If I'm watching it, I can flip into manual mode and quickly give it lots of throttle and rescue it, which is what I did that time. So just ignore this little drop down in the red part of the inward line. The rest of it should be fairly accurate. There's a bit of a drop down here for some reason at a kilometer. Not really sure what that's about. But when I saw this, I thought, wait a minute, this is going considerably further than my tests in Tokyo. So my tests in Tokyo were of this situation. And I had thought that with the noise of all the other things on the quadcopter, like the motors and ESCs and all that stuff, that even though I'm living in an area which has very little surrounding radio noise, I thought it might actually even out to be about the same as the situation in Tokyo. So I was expecting this graph to fade away at about 1400 meters like it did when I was doing this test last year. And also because when I did it a few days earlier, it faded away at about 1100 meters here. Even though these numbers were not being recorded properly, we can still see that, you know, they fade away at this point. And they did that twice on that day, didn't they? See? Same kind of thing. So so when I saw this, I thought, well, maybe the 1600 meter test is not enough for the dipole in this location with the very quiet radio area. So I went out another day and I did this little check around home. So I just walked around home, making sure that the values were what I expected with the dipole, because I hadn't expected it to be so strong. And I wanted just to make sure that it would actually go down to zero at some points when the signal was bad. So on the next day, I did one more trip and I used the dipole and I went all the way out to 2.3 kilometers with the dipole with the SD card data logging. And finally, we do actually see that the dipole does sort of drop off at a point, but it's still hanging in there, even past 2 kilometers a little bit. So you're getting 200 packets per second. Well, on the way out, no, it wasn't that good. On the way back, you can see as the quad turns around, the signal, so the red is the one coming back, signal jumps up quite a bit, and then as we're coming back, it's better. But if you wanted to pick a point where you would be comfortable using this, it might be about 1500 meters. Or actually, to be really confident with it, maybe 1 kilometer. But it does make sense that it's still hanging in there at over 2 kilometers, because the radio control, the transmitter that I'm using to fly the quadcopter, has basically one of these little dipoles inside it. The only difference between the radio control link and this one is that the radio control link receiver has two antennas. It has a diversity antenna and they're mounted at 90 degrees, so it will have better reception. But still, I guess it makes sense that this dipole can do okay at 2 kilometers still. So that's going to be it for this video. But looking at this graph back here for a minute, this kind of begs the question, doesn't it? How far can this Yagi antenna go? But that will have to be the topic of a future video, I think. Anyway, for now, thanks for watching.